Welcome to Whiteboard Programming, where we simplify programming with easy to understand whiteboard videos. And today I'll be sharing with you what is DeFi or decentralized finance and how it is going to change how financial firms work worldwide. So let's get started. First, what is DeFi or decentralized finance? Well, DeFi is a global peer-to-peer system of storing and transferring assets without the structure, restriction, and cost of a traditional centralized banking system. In fact, many bankers believe that DeFi can do everything a bank can do, only faster and more transparently. And this all is done through implementing digital smart contracts on public ledger blockchain like Ethereum. The need for DeFi comes from the fact that financial services are not available to everyone around the world. Almost 1.7 billion people around the world have no means or access to financial services, and equally, financial institutes can also not provide the necessary infrastructure to make money more accessible to people. And on the same note, the existing infrastructure is huge, but it does lack when it comes to reaching everyone out there. Now, with decentralization, the current infrastructure failures can be solved, as it has the potential to remove the failure points in the existing infrastructure and ensures that the records can be stored and shared among different nodes across the network. Also, with decentralization, one can transact on a peer-to-peer network without any centralized authority. I know what you're thinking about. Can't the existing financial infrastructure like banks work in any way? Well, for the current infrastructure to work, there is an overdependence on the centralized authority, as without its governance, rules, regulations, and reach, it is impossible to implement in some areas, especially in the places where wealth generation and distribution are less or inadequate. Also, centralized authority holds the power to delete accounts or block them if they deem so, and here, censorship might also be needed in some cases. But in reality, in most cases, it's restrictive and makes the end user suffer. Another key element of DeFi is the decentralized applications, or DApps. These decentralized applications enable the financial institutes to create functional apps on public blockchain and ensure that anyone can interact with them with a minimal cost per interaction. Next, let's discuss how does DeFi works. Well, fundamentally, DeFi works off a public decentralized blockchain network, stablecoins, and DeFi apps or decentralized apps. Here, blockchain continuously collects chunks of data and links them. Because of this, the past transactions are immutably and unbreakably documented. As each transaction here is publicly verified by every user, once it goes on the chain, it cannot be changed. Further, we all know that the decentralized nature of blockchain makes it more secure than any other alternative that depends on one centralized owner or authority like banks, corporations, and government. This technology enables the tracking of singular pieces of data like cryptocurrency payments so that financial transactions can be verified and traced back to their owners, giving it verifiable value that can be used even more securely than fiat currencies. Now, let's talk about some of the applications of DeFi and where all it can be applied. Number 1. Remittance market solution. The most significant impact of DeFi would be on the remittance market. The market surrounds the idea of sending millions of dollars across borders by workers that are working in foreign countries. These workers go through a lot of problems with sending the money, and one of their biggest problems is the fees that they have to pay in order to complete the transaction. This fees is usually between 6% to 24% of the overall transaction and depends on your individual use case too. And if you're someone who's already earning less, then you would have a lot lesser funds to send. With decentralized finance or DeFi, it will be possible to cut the cost associated with sending money by at least 50% or more. Number 2. Loans. Now, decentralized finance can also be proven very helpful when it comes to loan management. In general, the loan industry is very dependent on having access to banking. If you do not have access to banking or similar service, you cannot take a loan. This means that you also need to have proper credit score or a banking record that you can show to prove your eligibility for the loan. With DeFi, a platform can address the connectivity issues among lenders and borrowers. These DeFi loans enable users to lend their crypto to someone else and earn interest on the loan. As banks always have been utilizing the service to the fullest, now it's our time. As in the world of DeFi, anyone can become a lender, and easiest way to do so is through lending pools. Number 3. Stablecoins. While price volatility is common with cryptocurrencies still in their infancy, a number of solutions have been developed to combat the problem. Stablecoins limit price fluctuations by tracking the price of other assets. Their value is often pegged to traditional fiat currencies such as US dollar, and they can be thought of as a type of synthetic asset. Stablecoins are designed to be worth the same as the asset they're pegged to, and they're not just restricted to fiat currencies. In fact, when it comes to uses, stablecoins have many. They're often used for decentralized finance activities like liquidity mining, lending, and borrowing, and can also be used to earn yield. For example, currencies like ADAI pays interest on DAI deposited in Aave. Moreover, stablecoins can be used as an alternative to fiat currencies as transactions are settled on the blockchain, so they are often faster and more affordable than fiat money. Next, let's talk about traditional versus decentralized finance. You must be wondering, what makes traditional and decentralized finance different? The main difference is how they work. Traditional financial systems work with centralization, and it brings inefficiency and insecurity, as if the central authority fails, your money is lost. We all have heard about various security risks in our current traditional financial system, and the main source of this is cybercrime, as most of the transactions are at the risk of getting hacked, and all of this brings in both financial and data risks. DeFi, on the other hand, ensures that these issues are fixed to a certain extent. At the core, DeFi uses public blockchain, which means that it doesn't rely on centralized system or entity, and it can work without the need of proper infrastructure. Further, the two differ on 3 points. Number one, in decentralized finance, a public blockchain acts as the trust source governing all operations in a financial sector. In contrast, public governance, which entails laws and licensed financial institutions, acts as the trust source governing all operations in the traditional finance. Number two, decentralized finance continues to gain traction in part because it is more open and transparent than traditional finance. Here, the lack of barriers to enter means anybody with programming skills can take part in building financial services and tools on top of public blockchains. Number three, in contrast, cumbersome barriers to entry have made it improbable for traditional finance system to embrace the emerging trend. The fact that one must obtain proper licenses and authorization from regulators has limited innovation around the traditional financial systems. Further, a DeFi example includes Rainer AG. It is an independent Swiss asset management firm building blockchain ecosystem and currently is developing an ecosystem to bring fiat money and cryptocurrencies together as a single integrated financial tool. Further, let's talk about pros and cons of DeFi. Well, there are some major advantages of using DeFi, including cost, speed, and security. Anyone with the internet connection who has the access to blockchains and cryptocurrencies are able to make trades and move their assets whenever they want without having to wait on bank transfers or paying bank fees. In a nutshell, DeFi is fast. Here, the blockchain is also updated as soon as the transaction is made, and the interest rates are updated multiple times in 1 minute. Further, as the open nature of DeFi means that every single transaction can be seen by public, it makes it very hard for someone to steal cryptocurrency because of how blockchains logs transactions. You can also invest on securities market and conduct peer-to-peer activities. For example, BitPay can be used to make purchases for physical goods that are typically paid in dollars by transferring crypto into cash. The economic impact of COVID-19 and how banks responded revealed another potential benefit of DeFi. In response to the pandemic's recession, some central banks slashed interest rates to maintain consumer spending and protect the economy. However, that has cut the effective net worth of savers. Under a DeFi regime, it would be a much more difficult task for a central bank to manipulate the value of its currency. In other words, DeFi enables users to guard the value of their asset from central bank manipulation. Now, you must be thinking that DeFi is awesome, right? Well, not everything is positive when it comes to decentralized finance. Some challenges need to be covered to make it more viable to different governments and organizations out there. One of the biggest challenges that DeFi has to encounter is the adoption rate, as even though we all are connected through the internet, we rarely have public awareness regarding DeFi, and by not many people knowing about DeFi, it can impact its adoption rate. In fact, to your surprise, there are very few people that even know about crypto. I know what you're thinking right now, but the reality is that crypto has gained its popularity during the Bitcoin price rise, and still, it's nowhere near the internet or other more popular technologies out there. Further, even though public blockchains are technically capable of accepting every one of us out there, it lacks the bandwidth to work efficiently. And in comparison, companies like Visa can process huge number of transactions per second. Next, I would like you to know that DeFi users are not able to guard the value of their assets from market gyrations, and the value here fluctuates frequently and sometimes extremely. Ethereum transaction rates can also fluctuate, so trading could potentially become more expensive. Further, decentralized apps or DApps are relatively new technology, and weakness or liabilities may yet emerge. In addition, there is also an array of potential tax implications that come with purchasing, trading, and investing via DeFi. But let's talk about it in some other video. Finally, the shape of emerging policies and regulatory schemes have yet to be determined. In particular, it remains to be seen how regulators will respond to stablecoins coexisting with central bank digital currencies. As a key takeaway, I'd like you to remember that DeFi is globalized and permissionless, meaning anyone anywhere has the access to funds and other assets at any time without incurring penalties or fees levied by banks or other traditional financial institutions. Widespread use of DeFi could speed up the transition to a cashless society, and to an extent, cybercrimes might also be reduced as blockchain technology tracks and secures each transaction, meaning it would require a massive coordinated cyber attack to disrupt the chain, and this is what exactly makes an attack highly improbable. With that, I hope this video was helpful to you and served value. If you love my content, feel free to smash that like button, and if you haven't already subscribed to the channel, please do, as it keeps me motivated and helps me create more content like this for you.